very glad to be in front of you to talk today about solvent extraction processes for the recovery of strategic and critical reserves. Actually, you understood that I'm a chemist, and I'm going to talk only on one part of hydrometallurgical processes, solvent extraction. And you will see during this presentation that chemistry is very important in solvent extraction processes. Because hydrometallurgy is a very huge field of the industry, and when you do hydrometallurgy, you need skills in many, many fields, including chemistry, engineering chemistry, geology, geoscience, material chemistry, but also engineering chemistry. Then, in this presentation, after a brief introduction, I'm going to introduce you the principle of solvent extraction. What is the physical chemistry which is involved in solvent extraction processes? And after that, we will see a few case of studies. Actually, I prepared my presentation for a course of 3 hours, but it means it's only 2 hours, and I'm going to shorten a little bit this presentation. And in particular, I want to talk about SX and electrometallurgy in copper production. You will see that in certain cases, you have to purify the solution if you want to perform electrorefining or electrowinning in copper production. And these two other examples will be the solvent extraction for the recovery of niobium and tantalum, and solvent extraction for the recovery of uranium from unconventional resources, which is wet phosphoric acid. Then let's start with the introduction. I think so you have heard about the societal challenges of the 21st century. These societal challenges were defined not only in Europe by the European Commission, but also in other countries, in the US or in Canada, for instance. And the societal challenges are the clean energy, the health and demography, the food, the smart and grid transports, climate and environment, but also raw materials, including oil, gas, and metals. And of course, in this presentation, I'm going to focus on metal. Then today, the deposits, the earths, are very complex, more complex than in the past. And today, we must think about new processes which are capable to extract metals from polymetallic earths and low-grade earths. These earths can be from primary resources or secondary resources. You have here, for sake of illustration, a tree which shows base metals, copper, platinum, nickel, and you can see that when you have copper, you have many other elements. You have platinum, platinoid, PGM, you have cobalt, gold, silver, and this is the same for the other metals. Then, ores are not only composed of only one metal, there are many metals, and when you want to valorize metals from the ores, you have to extract one metal among a lot of other metals. This is the same case in the secondary resources. You can see on this figure that the materials, the spent materials, which were used in the life, was very simple, only few metals. Today, in our materials, in our laptops, in our smartphone, we have many, many metals, and we have strategic metals. And like in the primary resources, you have an increase of the complexity of the resources in the secondary resources. Then we can say that spent materials, the material that we want to recycle at the end of life, can be considered to be as global mining. For instance, if you want to produce 1 ton of lithium, you can produce lithium from brine, for instance in Bolivia or in Argentina, or you can produce lithium from ores. If you produce lithium from brine, you're going to use evaporation, solar evaporation processes. It means that you're going to put the brine in a pool and you're going to wait for a few months, and by evaporation, the water is going to go outside the pool and you're going to precipitate the different salts. You will precipitate potassium chloride, magnesium chloride, and at the end of the process, you're going to precipitate lithium chloride. Then you will be able to recover very easily lithium chloride, and after that you can perform purification processes to refine that and to obtain a product with high grade, which can be used in the batteries for the laptops, for instance. High-grade products. Then if you want to produce 1 ton of lithium, you will need 250 tons of ores or 750 tons of brine. And if you want to produce this ton of lithium from spent batteries, spent lithium-ion batteries, you will need only 28 tons. It means that you can say that spent materials are really a mine, a urban mining. Then it's interesting to think about recycling to have opportunities to valorize metals. And one of the challenges of the 21st century is to consume more with less, to have a smart consumption. If you have a look to this figure, you can see that today we will need about 1.5 Earth to meet our needs. And if we do nothing, we will need more than 2 Earth. We define the overshoot day. The overshoot day is the day when resource use is expected to outstrip the capacity for production. And in 2016, the overshoot day was on the 8th of August. It means that this overshoot day is getting earlier every year, and it means that humans consume the raw resource that the Earth can produce in only 8 months. Then, that's why we say that a good consumption of resources is really a challenge. This figure is also very interesting. It shows the production between 1919 and 2050 in tons of 14 raw materials, including aluminium, gold, copper, chromium, etc., etc. You can see that you have a strong increase of the production of these minerals, of these raw materials, and it's interesting to note that we will have to produce more raw materials between 2010 and 2050 than we produce between the beginning of the humanity and 2010. Then that's why we think about new processes which can extract metals from the new resources, including primary and secondary resources. Especially, we are very interested by two kinds of metals, the strategic metals. The strategic metals is defined as metal which is basically or mineral which is important for some kind of industrial processes or other use. And some experts tend to define strategic metals as metals that are in short supply in a particular country or region, or which are needed to manufacture products or another major process that contribute to the national gross domestic product. It means that the definition of strategic metals is different from one country to another country. And we have to define also the critical metals. The critical metals are required for the economic development only, but which again are at risk of supply disruption. Then, recently, the European Union defined a map like that, which sort the metals between the supply risk and the economic importance. This kind of map is for Europe, and it changes every year, it depends, it can change in the time, and it can be different from the map in US, for instance. You can see that niobium is considered as a metal of economic importance and high supply risk, and tantalum is really a metal of high economic importance with a moderate supply. Uranium for France is not present in Europe in this map, but uranium from France is really strategic because you know that we have 80% of our energy which is from nuclear reactors. Then our electricity is produced by nuclear reactors. Uranium is strategic for us, but not really strategic for Europe. And rare earth is very strategic and it costs a lot. It's very strategic because China produces a lot as a monopoly of rare earth production. A few years ago, they produced about 90% of the production of rare earths. Today it's less because in order to decrease the monopoly, to reduce the monopoly of China, we decided to build plants, for instance in Australia, to produce, to be autonomous, to produce ourselves rare earths. Then, to process these raw materials, we can process that by parametallurgy or we can process by hydrometallurgy. In parametallurgy, we're going to do chemistry and process at high temperature in furnace, whereas in hydrometallurgy, we'll be at room temperature or in sometimes we can be at high pressure and relatively high temperature, but we're going to dissolve the raw material in a liquid, in aqueous solution. That's why we call that hydrometallurgy. Then there are two routes, parametallurgy or hydrometallurgy. And in hydrometallurgy, this is the goal of my presentation, first of all, we have to characterize the ore, to characterize the waste in case of secondary resources. After that, we're going to process crushing and grinding. We're going to crush and grind the ore and physical separation. And after that, we can work on leaching, I mean to dissolve the material, the ore, into an aqueous solution. And after that, we have not only one metal, we have many metals from the materials, from the ore, and then we must purify. And we can purify by solvent extraction, ion exchange resin, or also by precipitation or crystallization. In this talk, I'm going to focus on solvent extraction. And after the purification, we're going to perform electrometallurgy if we want to transform to obtain a metal, or we're going to perform precipitation if we want to have a salt, which could be used to make other products. Then you see that we need really many skills to work on hydrometallurgy. We need skill in geoscience, in mineralogy, we need skill in mechanics for crushing, grinding, we need skills in solution chemistry, in thermodynamics, interfacial chemistry for leaching, purification, we have reaction at the interface between solid, liquid and gas, and we need as well skills in chemical engineering, modeling and simulation. Then, as I said to you, today I'm going to focus on solvent extraction. What is solvent extraction? I think so you know a little bit this method. You have two phases which are non-miscible, an aqueous phase and an organic phase. It's like when you make a vinaigrette, when you mix vinegar and oil, you're going to have two phases which are not miscible. And when you have a solute in the aqueous solution, this solute is going to be distributed, partitioned between the aqueous solution and the organic phase. It means that you have an equilibrium between the organic and the aqueous phases. That means that if you have an equilibrium, that means that the chemical potential in thermodynamics are equal for the solute in the aqueous phase and in the organic phase. Then you can say that this guy is equal to this guy. And when you develop the equation of the chemical potential, you can demonstrate that you have a ratio between the activity of the solute, it can be the metal, in the organic phase versus the activity of the solute in the aqueous phase, and this ratio depends on the standard chemical potential of the solute in the aqueous and the organic phase. And this value is constant. It means that the ratio of the activity of the solute are constant, and this constant is the distribution constant, which is a thermodynamic constant. Actually, it's very difficult to calculate the activity of solute in aqueous or in organic solution, because if you want to calculate that, you have to calculate the activity coefficient, which show you the interaction between the solute and the solvent, and between the solutes and the solutes. And like it's very difficult in solvent extraction, we're going to simplify that. We're going to say, okay, we are almost close to the ideality, even if it's not true, in the aqueous and the organic phase, and we're going to replace this ratio by another ratio, which is the ratio of the solute in the, of the concentration of the solute in the organic phase over the concentration of the solute in the atmosphere. This coefficient is not constant because it's not a thermodynamic constant. It's a distribution ratio, and it's very important. It means that more of the distribution ratio is high, better will be the extraction. And the other, the second thing that we define is the extraction efficiency. The extraction, we can demonstrate that the extraction efficiency depends on the distribution ratio and mu, which is the ratio between the volume of the organic phase versus over the volume of the atmosphere. Then these two parameters are very important in extraction, in solvent extraction, because they give us information about the ability to extract or not a solute. But as I said to you, we have an aquosphase. The aquosphase is the phase which comes from the leaching. It's a solution, aqueous solution, which comes from the leaching of the ore. When you dissolve with an acid, for instance, the ore or the material, you will have an aqueous solution containing the metals. This is this phase. And for the organic phase in solvent extraction, actually it's a mixture of two or three components. You have the diluent, you have the phase modifier, and the extractant. The extractant will help the solute to be transferred from the aqueous phase into the organic phase. It's a molecule which can complex the metals and help to assist for the transfer from the aqueous phase to the organic phase, to extract. The phase modifier is used to increase the polarity of the solvent and to favor the solubility, to increase the solubility of the metal complex in the organic phase, and it avoids the third phase formation. I will talk about third phase formation a little bit later. And the diluent will bring all the physicochemical properties, the density, for instance, the flash count for the security, etc., etc. Then you have this extraction solvent with three components, two or three components. Sometimes we need a phase modifier, sometimes we don't need phase modifier, and you have the aqueous phase. And these two phases are at the equilibrium, at the steady state. But it's really a very complicated system, because in the aqueous phase you have many, many reactions. You can have complexation, you can have hydrolysis, you can have oxidation and reduction reactions, electrochemical reaction, you can have precipitation, you can have acidic dissociation as well. In the organic phase, it's a little bit complicated as well, because you can have the presence of chelates, solvates, mixed complex, or ion pairs. But you can have reverse micelles. I don't know if you know what is reverse micelle, but actually, we'll see, the extractants are surfactants. That means that they like to be at the interface. They like to be at the aqueous-aqueous interface, because they are surfactants. And when the concentration of the extractant is higher than the micellar, critical micellar concentration, you will form reverse micelles. It's small entities, small aggregates of molecules which are in the organic phase, like that. Then it means that in the organic phase you have species at the molecular scales, and you have species at the supramolecular scales. Then it's very complicated. And between these two phases you have the interface. And this interface is very important, because the kinetics of extractions will depend on the interface. Then, solvent extraction, even if you can think that it's easy, I have just to put an aqueous phase with an organic phase, and I just have to check, is actually more complicated if you want to understand the physical chemistry, or if you want to model solvent extraction processes. Then, what are the diluent? The diluent must have a low cost. They must allow to reduce the size of the equipment, to reduce the cost of the process. They must exhibit high selectivity to extract one metals, to towards another metal, and they must allow high exchange rate at the interface. Of course, they must be safe and green as well. And then the choice of the solvent is crucial and complex in solvent extraction. We want a solvent of extraction with high extraction capacity, high selectivity, easy recovery of the solute on the solvent. It's good to extract the metals, but when you have extracted the metal from the aqueous phase, selectively from the aqueous phase into the organic phase, you have to remove the metals in a second step from the organic phase to perform precipitation, for instance. Then you must have reversible system, good reversibility. When you extract, you must strip. A low solubility in the raffinate, because if you have a high solubility of the extractant in the raffinate, you're going to pollute the raffinate, and then it means that you have to process the effluent, and it's costly, it's expensive. It must be chemically inert for the equipment, no reactivity for the gas, the basket or the mixer setters, for instance. High kinetics of transfer and good physico-chemical properties. The viscosity must be between 1 and 3 centipoise. The surface tension must be between 5 and 40 millinewton per meter, and the density must be between 700 and 900 kilograms per cubic meters. It's very important because if you have these good properties, the settlement of the two phase will be zero. Because in solvent extraction, the first thing you're going to do, you're going to mix the aqueous phase and the organic phase in order to increase the surface of transfer, in order to get easier the transfer of metal from the aqueous phase into the organic phase. And after that, you're going to settle in order to separate the organic and the aqueous phase. And if you want to separate easily, the organic and aqueous phase must not be too viscous, and the density must be quite different. Usually, the aqueous phase is greater than unity. Then it means that if you want to have a good separation of the aqueous and organic phase, a good settlement, you need a density which is quite different. 700 is a good density. Then, what about the diluent? The diluent, you have many kinds of diluent. Actually, it's a kerosene. And in this kerosene, you can have aromatic compounds at different concentration. You can have Solvay-So 150. It's a diluent with more than 99% of aromatics. Or you can have the White Spirit HPE. In this diluent is only kerosene with only 2% of aromatics. Today, we prefer using alkyl kerosene with low concentration of aromatics, because aromatics compounds are not good for the health. Then you can see that the density are between 7 and 900 kilograms per cubic meters, and you can see that the flash count is quite different between White Spirit WS and Solvay-So 150. What we want a high value of the flash pound in order to be safe. For the phase modifier, usually it's long alkyl, there are long alkyl chains alcohol with between 8 and 12 atoms of carbon. It can be tridecanol or non-1,4-phenol. TPP can also play the role of phase modifier, as well as aromatic modifier. That means that if you use this kind of diluent, you have a very high content of aromatic, and I just said that aromatic is also a modifier. It means that when you are going to use Solvay-So as diluent, you don't need to use a phase modifier. Then what is the role? To improve the phase separation during extraction, during the settlement, to avoid surface formation, and to improve the metal species solubility in the organic phase. For the extractant, we have three kinds of extractants. We have the neutral agents. The neutral agents, the most common one is 3-butylphosphate, TDP, which is used to process spent nuclear fuel, to extract uranium and plutonium from spent fuel from nuclear reactors in nitric acid at high concentration. It's a very robust extractant molecule. And the second most famous molecule is trioptylphosphine oxide, this molecule, which can be used in mixture of other extracting agents as well. Then we have the neutral agents. The extraction efficiency of neutral agent does not depend on the pH of the aqueous solution. We have cationic exchangers. Then how it works, you have here a metal in the aqueous phase. You're going to extract the metal in the organic phase. For that, you're going to use a cationic exchanger. We say that it's a cationic exchanger because you have one metal from the aqueous phase which goes into the organic phase, and one cation from the aqueous phase which goes into the organic phase, and one cation, the proton, from the organic phase which goes in the aqueous phase. That means that we have an exchange between the cation, metal cation, and between and the proton. That's why we say that this kind of extracting agents are cationic exchangers. Then we can define an extraction constant in thermodynamics, which is the ratio of the concentration of the product over the reactives. And from that, we can deduce that easily that we have a relationship between the distribution ratio of the metals and the concentration of the extracting agent and the pH. It means that the logarithm of the distribution ratio of the metals depends on the pH and the concentration of the extractant in the organic phase. It means that when you're going to increase the pH of the solution, you're going to increase the extraction of the metals when you use a cationic exchanger in the solvent. And typically, you have some examples, of course. This isotherms shows the extraction efficiency for various metals, copper, manganese, calcium, nickel, aluminium, as a function of pH when the extractant is SanX272. SanX272 is an extractant which is usually used for the recovery of nickel and cobalt. It's very selective. You can extract nickel and cobalt very selectively. Then you can separate both metals. Usually when you have a laterite, or you have nickel and you have cobalt in the ore, and if you want to separate both metals, it's very difficult because the electronic properties of the metal are very similar. And SanX272 can separate the metals, and then you can recover cobalt and recover metal separately. But it's interesting to see that when the aqueous solution is sulfate media, these curves are quite different from the curve when it's chloride media. For instance, you can see here that you will have the extraction of cobalt and after the extraction of manganese in sulfate media, while in chloride media, this is the contrary. You will first extract cobalt on magnesium at another pH. You have anionic exchangers. Anionic exchangers, it's usually it's amine. It's amine, like trioptylamine, for instance. Here you will have then the extraction of an anion from the aqueous phase into the organic phase, and you will have an anion from the organic phase which is going to be transferred into the aqueous phase. Then you have an exchange of an anion from the aqueous phase into the organic phase and vice versa. It means that that's why we say it's an anionic exchanger. Then you have here, you can see such a kind of extractant, the extraction of metals by using anionic exchanger doesn't depend on the pH. It depends only on the anion concentration. And then you can see the extraction efficiency when you use trioptylamine with decanal and kerosene in the organic phase as extraction solvent. and a solution at pH 2 for the hypostase, you can see that you're going to extract molybdenum very early, and it's more difficult to extract nickel and chromium. But it means that if you want to use a cationic exchanger, you need to add in solution cations. You can only extract the cations. If you use an ionic exchanger, you can only extract anions. If you use a neutral agent, you can only extract neutral species. Then, depending on the speciation of the metals in the hypostase, you can choose to use a cationic exchanger, an anionic exchanger, or a neutral agent. Then, the knowledge of the speciation, how the species are there cationic, anionic, neutral species, is very important, because by knowing the speciation in the hypostase, you will have an idea of what kind of extracting agents you're going to use in the extraction solvent. Then you can use cationic exchanger, anionic exchanger, or neutral agent, but you can mix together cationic exchanger and neutral agent as well. This is what we call, when you mix cationic exchanger or neutral agent, you can have a synergistic effect or an antagonist effect. It means that you're going to have an increase of the extraction efficiency by using a mixture of cationic exchanger or anionic exchanger. In this case, it's synergistic effect. Or you can have a reduction, a decrease of the extraction efficiency when you use a mixture of cationic exchanger and neutral agent. How can we explain that? Why we have antagonist effect in certain cases? When you have a strong interaction between the cationic exchanger and the neutral agent, then this molecule will prefer interacting with together rather than interacting with the metals. In this case, you're going to decrease the extraction efficiency. For the synergistic effect, first of all, you have the metal. In this metal, you have in the solvation shell what molecules of water. You're going to use at the interface the cationic exchanger. The cationic exchanger will remove few molecules of water from the solvation shell, because it's going to complex the metal, and then few molecules of water are going to go outside the solvation shell, and then you will have a metal which will be with a hydrophobic environment. That means that this complex will prefer going into the organic phase rather than staying into the hypostase, because of the hydrophobic environment. But there are still few molecules of water in the solvation shell. And then if you use a second extractant, a neutral agent, because this species is a neutral species, you can think that this neutral agent will remove the other molecules of water, and then you're going to increase again the hydrophobicity around the metal, and then you're going to favor the extraction of the metal into the organic phase. Then the synergistic effect is due to the presence of two molecules, which is going to remove almost all water molecules around the metals, and then increase the hydrophobicity around the metals, and then favor the extraction of the metal. Then, depending on the nature of the extracting agent, of the cationic exchanger, of the neutral agent, and depending on the nature of the metal and its speciation, you could have a synergistic effect or an antagonist effect when you're going to mix cationic exchanger and neutral agent. Then here you have some battery problem. No. Then, for the cationic exchanger, you have this kind of molecules, D2HPA, D2-ethyl ethyl phosphoric acid, is a famous extracting agent. You have Sanex-272 as well. And have this kind of molecule. This one is used for copper extraction. Copper extraction by solvent extraction. You have the leaks of provided by BASF, or you can use a cousin of the leaks, which is Acorga, which is not exactly the same molecule, but of the same molecule of the same family, which is provided by Cytec Solvay. Then you have actually you have many extracting agents which were tested, but in reality there are only between 5 and 10 extracting agents which are on the market for all the metals that we extract. Other neutral agents, as I said, you tributyl phosphine oxide, or anionic exchanger, which are amine, such as alanine 3-6 or aliquot 3-6, which are provided by BASF. So they provide something which is similar to alanine 3-6 as well. Then I said you that in certain cases we can observe surface formation. What is the origin of surface formation? Actually, we don't have only surface formation, because as I said you, extractants are surfactants, then extractants tend to form micelles, and in certain cases it can form microemulsion. And we don't want microemulsion in solvent extraction because we want two non-miscible phases. Then, depending on the concentration of the extractant, depending on the concentration of water and in the system, in the organic phase, you can form reverse micelle, you can form direct micelle, you can form this kind of aggregate, laminar aggregates. Then it's very complicated. And there is a Winsor classification for the microemulsion. When you have a system with an organic phase and a microemulsion of organic phase in of organic droplets in water, you have a system with the classification of 1 in the Winsor classification. In the Winsor classification, the number 2 is for a system when you have water and microemulsion of droplet of water into the organic phase. You have the third classification in Winsor classification, which is the formation of the third phase, the surface formation. You have water, you have organic phase, and you have a third phase, the formation of a third phase, which can be droplet of solvent in water, or droplet of water in solvent. And you have the first classification, which is microemulsion. In this case, you don't have two phases, you have only one phase, which is a microemulsion of water in solvent, or of solvent in water. We don't want this, because if you have microemulsion, it means that you are not able, you cannot separate both phases, then it's a problem, because we can work only when we have two phases. We don't want that because we have a third phase and we don't know how to manage the system with three phases. And we can work with this kind of, usually we work with this kind of systems because even if we have a low solubility of organic phase in water, we can have some fine, very small droplets which are staying in the aqueous phase. And in this case, it means that we have to treat the effluent. But what is the origin? What is the origin of the third phase? I said you that in organic phase we form micelles, and if the third phase is due to the fact that the micelles are going to collapse together, and by collapsing together, they are going to form their own phase. This is the third phase. Then, if you want to avoid the third phase formation, you have to add something to avoid that the micelles are going to collapse. And for that, you're going to add a third phase modifier, which is an alcohol, for instance, with a long alkyl chain. And you can see that this phase will differ. Then you have the micelle. The micelle is a core with water, metal, acid. And around the core, you will have the extracting agents, which form the micelle. Then you have a pool. In the pool, you have the metals, you have water, you have inorganic acid. And this pool is formed by the extracting agents, which form a micelle. And the tridecanal, the phasmodifer, can go into the micelles here between the extractant molecules. And it, like phasmodifer exhibit a very long alkyl chain, it means that you will have repulsive interaction, and then you won't have collapse, the micelles are not going to collapse due to the presence of the long alkyl chain. Then you will have a repulsion, and the presence of this alkyl chain from the phase modifier will avoid the third phase formation. But when you have a third phase formation, you have three phases. You have you have the apostase, you have an AV phase, which is between the aqueous phase and the light phase. In the AV phase, you have high extractant and metal concentration and a low amount of diluent. The AV phase is composed of micelles which have collapsed together. And you have the light phase, which is a diluent and a low concentration of extracting agents. Okay. Then collapse of micelles are in the AV cells, in AV phase, and the light phase is almost only constituted of diluent. And the third phase is the aqueous solution. Okay, then, do you have any question about solvent extraction? Oh, everything is clear? Yeah? Okay, then now I'm going to talk to you about solvent extraction and electrometallurgy in a copper extraction plant. In copper production. First of all, as I said, we're going to crush, we're going to grind, we're going to dress the ore, and after that, we have to dissolve the ore, including copper, in solution, in aqueous solution, by using acids. It can be sulfuric acid, for instance. You can do that in dynamic leaching. You put the ore with the acid in a reactor, and you mix. You can increase the temperature, or in certain cases, you can increase the pressure in order to increase again the temperature so that you can dissolve the metals, high pressure leaching. Or you can use heat leaching. Heat leaching is very usual in copper industry. For instance, here you have a picture of heat leaching in New Mexico, the state of New Mexico in the US. And then you have a heap, and on this heap you're going to put tubes with holes, and in the tube with holes you're going to have a flux of sulfuric acid, and then sulfuric acid is going through the porosity of the heap from the top to the bottom of the heap, and then it's a very low rate process, because you can have heap leaching during more than 10 months, and at the bottom of the heap you're going to recover the solution. But when the solution is going to percolate into the heap, you're going to recover in sulfuric acid metals, including copper. Then the acidic solution will contain a lot of metals, including copper, and after that you're going to contact the leaching solution with the organic phase in solvent extraction, in mixer settlers, in order to purify, in order to remove other metals, in order to recover the metal copper, and after recovering the copper, you can perform electrometallurgy to produce copper cathode. Then, what is electrometallurgy? It can be used for the production of metals. It's electrowinning, or for purification of metals, it's electro-refining from salt oxide or sulfur by electrochemical processes. There are two kinds of electrolysis processes: electrowinning of salt in chloride or sulfate solution, in aqueous solution to produce metals such as copper, zinc, nickel, cobalt, cadmium, chromium, and to purify by you can think about the electro-refining of copper or nickel. You can perform electrolysis of salt in chloride solution or oxide, in this case dissolved in molten salt at high temperature, in order to obtain metal. This is the case for the aluminium production in Bayer process, or the magnesium from magnesium chloride, molten salt. Then, electrolysis in aqueous phase is limited by proton reduction. When you want to deposit onto a cathode a metal which exhibits a potential which is lower than the reduction of the proton, you cannot work in aqueous solution. In this case, you have to work in another media, and this media is molten salt. It's very complicated because it's electrochemistry at very high temperature. This is the case, for instance, for aluminium, titanium, magnesium, sodium. You can see that the redox potential is very low, minus 1.3, minus 2.0 for aluminium and magnesium. Then you cannot use aqueous solution to perform electrochemical process. But in the case of copper, you can use electrochemical process because the redox potential is greater than the reduction of the proton. Then, what is the principle of electrolysis? You have here an example of electrowinning process. You have the cathode, you have the anode, you have an electrolyte, and you're going to pass current between the cathode and the anode. At the cathode, you will have the reduction of the metal from the aqueous phase onto the cathode to form, in the case of copper, copper metal. And at the anode, you will have oxidation. If you are in chloride solution, it could be chloride oxidation, but usually we want to avoid the use of chloride due to the corrosive properties of chloride. And how can we proceed during electrometallurgy? We use the Faraday's law. The Faraday's law permits to calculate the theoretical weight of copper. And you can see that the theoretical weight of copper, which is deposited onto the cathode, depends on the time and depends on the current. Of course, the theoretical weight is a little bit different from the experimental weight, because you have biside reactions such as water oxidation, which will consume electrons, and then the efficiency is not equal to 100%. All the electrons are not used for the deposition of the metals, because there are other reactions. Then what are the electrolysis parameters? You have the electrochemical deposition. The frailty of the deposition depends on crystal nucleation and crystal growth, which are influenced by the temperature. And an increase of temperature will increase the transfer phenomena and increase the dissolution rate as well. The nature of the cathode and its surface state: the deposition can be more or less adherent onto the cathode, and variation of overvoltage can occur due to gas formation. The current density is another parameter. It will affect the coulombic efficiency and the morphology of the deposited film. And the presence of impurities can change dramatically the quality of the deposit. Impurities act on the quality and adherence of the deposited film. Then that's why, in certain cases, you have to purify the solution to be sure that you will have you won't have impurities in solution which can dramatically change the quality of the deposits. And such kind of purification can be performed by solvent extraction, for instance, before electrometallurgy, as I said. Copper electrorefining, then the production of copper at 20% from electrorefining. You have leaching, solvent extraction to purify, and after that you can perform copper electrodeposition. And 80% of the production comes from electrorefining, which is a purification stage. Then what is electrorefining? You can produce copper by pyrometallurgy, but sometimes the copper production is not very pure. You have impurities with copper, and if you want to purify the anode from the copper from pyrometallurgy, you can use electrorefining. Then in this case you will have anode. In the anode you have the copper with the impurities which comes from the pyrometallurgical process, and you will have a cathode which is called the mother plate, which is a plate of copper or inox. This is a cathode. And you will have anode, cathode, anode, cathode, anode, cathode. Then you will have anodic copper. Anodic copper is stripped from the cathode, then you're going to pass a current from the anode to the cathode, so that you will have a dissolution of the cathode. The copper is going to be dissolved into the aqueous phase due to the electrochemical reaction, this one. And this copper, which goes into the electrolyte, is going to be deposited onto the anode by this kind of reaction. You're going to dissolve the copper from the anode, which is going into the electrolyte, and the copper is going to go to the cathode by this reaction and will be deposited onto the cathode. But impurities which are in the anode have lower deposition potential than copper. And in this case, they will have no deposition of impurities onto the cathode. And then you're going to purify on the mother plate, you will have copper without any impurities. And you work in an acidic solution, low pH, in order to limit water reduction, because you know that water, the potential of water reduction depends on the pH, and also to avoid the formation of hydroxide, which can modify the quality of the deposition. Then, as I said, what are the operating conditions of copper electrorefining? Usually, the current density is between 200-250. Ampere per square meters, and if you use higher current density you can have bad quality of electrodeposited film due to high electrodeposition rate. If you increase the current, you're going to increase the kinetic of deposition, and then you will have disorder and bad quality deposition. Then in electrometallurgy you have to optimize the current density, the concentration of sulfate, if you are in sulfate solution, and the temperature. Usually you can use this kind of abacus, which shows the variation of the degradation rate as a function of the current which is applied in the process. The degradation rate is the ratio between the specific surface and the geometric surface. In the specific surface, you're going to take into account the porosity of the electrode. Why you're not going to take into account the porosity of the electrode in the geometric surface? It means that by adding this ratio, you can have an idea of the porosity, the tortuosity, the quality of the deposition onto the electrode. And you can see that current density which is greater than the critical current density, you can observe the formation of dendrites. And the formation of dendrites is very dangerous because you can have short circuits, and it can be very, very bad for the plant. You can have safety problems. Okay, then I have time here? Yeah, 30 minutes again? No?
No, a quarter hour. 15 minutes.
Okay, that's very good. Then the fourth point is solvent extraction for a sustainable recovery of niobium and tantalum. As I said to you in the beginning of this presentation, niobium and tantalum are really critical strategic metals. If you remember the map from the European Union. What is the production of niobium? It's greater than 75,000 tons per year. It's not very big. They are used in automotive steels, pipeline steels, jet engines, and structural steels. In this case, to produce this kind of product, you will use raw material, you will use a mixture of iron and niobium as raw material. And this mixture of iron and niobium, with more than 55% of niobium in this alloy, represent about 90% of the niobium market. But you can use niobium in lens, in medical implants, in catalysts, in superconducting magnets, but also in cones to produce cones, then in many strategic areas. And in this case, the raw material which is used to produce this kind of devices is niobium oxide at a purity which is greater than 99.9%. Then you can choose to produce this kind of product, low-grade product, or this kind of product for high technologies, which is a high-grade product. For tantalum, the production is between 500 and 2,000 tons a year. It is used for high-temperature alloys, electronic components, capacitors, hard drive, cutting tools, medical implants, but also micelle, projectiles. And in this case, the raw materials used to produce this kind of product is a concentrate of tantalum oxide or fluoride, which contain between 20 and 99.99% of tantalum. It depends on the application. But how can we produce this kind of alloy or this kind of concentrate?
Ferro niobium for use in the car, in which part of the car is used, the ferro niobium?
Ferro niobium, it's used for steels, automotive steels.
Automotive steels.
Yeah, and for flat as well, plane.
Yeah, but plane normally is aluminium. What is the...
For the...
The turbine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The turbine. Then, processes for niobium and tantalum production. First of all, you're going to perform beneficiation. You have two main processes, a process used by IAM Gold in Naldec mine and by Global Advanced Metals in the Greenbushes mine. In this process, you will start by pyrochlore, and then you're going to perform ore dressing. You're going to crush, to grind, in order to liberate the niobium. And after that, you can perform physical separation, physico-chemical separation by flotation. You have carbonate, then you're going to float the carbonate. After that, you can perform magnetic separation at low intensity to separate the magnetic fraction from the non-magnetic fraction. And you can use dynamine to perform flotation of pyroclar. And after that, xanthanes to perform flotation of sulfur. After that, you have a concentrate containing niobium, but not only niobium, and you can perform leaching for the hydrometallurgical route to obtain a concentrate containing about 54% of niobium oxide. And this concentrate can be treated by pyrometallurgy or by hydrometallurgy. Pyrometallurgy will lead to the formation, to the production of ferroniobium, it's 90% of the market, while hydrometallurgy will be used to produce purified niobium oxide, but after that you have to perform niobium tantalum separation. Then for the crushing, you can use gyratory crusher, jaw in the beneficiation, drill crusher, roll crusher, or hammer mills. And for the flotation, you can, after that you can perform grinding with this kind of equipment, ball mill or roll mill. I think so, you know that because it's very usual in the copper industry, but very high amount, you process very high flux in copper industry. You can perform, I said, flotation. I don't know if you know exactly what is force flotation, you know, okay, it's perfect. Or magnetic separation. Then, as I said, you have the ferronodium. Then after, you can perform parametallurgy to process, to treat the ferro, to obtain the ferronodium. Then for that, you have the niobium concentrate, which comes from the concentration stage with flotation, magnetic separation, etc. You're going to mix the niobium concentrate with iron oxide in the good proportion to have the good alloy containing 66% of niobium, and you will add aluminium powder as well, which is a reductant because the process is performed under reductive conditions. Then you prepare the mixture, you mix, you compress, and after that you put that in a furnace at 2400 degrees to perform the reduction, and you will separate the slag from the ferronodium. It's classical parametallurgy. Now, if you want to separate niobium from tantalum, if you want to use hydrometallurgical process to produce niobium and to produce tantalum, the problem is that this process is a risky process. It's a risky process because in this process you will use HF, a mixture of HF and sulfuric acid. And you know that HF is very dangerous and not very sustainable. And you have to use also MIBK to perform solvent extraction or octanol, but many plants use MIBK. The problem with MIBK is that the flash point is very, very low, 14 degrees. It means it's very dangerous. You have a very high flammability of the solvent. Then that's why it's a risky process, and that's why we have to think of alternative options to separate niobium and tantalum, but it's not so easy because the chemistry of such media are very complicated. Then we're going to have a look in detail about this process, The first stage is leaching. Then you have your niobium tantalum concentrate for hydrometallurgy. You're going to leach it by using the mixture of HF and sulfuric acid. You will have a residue because you don't have 100% of leaching efficiency, of course. Then you have a residue. And at the output of the leaching process, you have high concentration of fluoride, 13 molar and 3 molar sulfuric acid. It means that you use a large amount of HF. It's very expensive and it's very dangerous. What are the reactions during the leaching stage? First of all, the HF is going to react with niobium oxide to form these species. And HF can react as well with tantalum oxide to form these species. You can see that when you use HF, you will have two different species. Niobium oxygen and 5 fluoride atoms, and here only 7 fluoride for one tantalum. It means that the properties of niobium and tantalum will be very different. Usually, if you have a look to the Mendeleev table, you can see that niobium and tantalum are very close together. It means that they have the same electronic properties. Actually, niobium and tantalum are very similar, and it's very difficult to separate them from each other because they are similar. If you use HF, you will have two different speciations, then it will be easier to perform the separation by solvent extraction. Sorry. Then, after leaching, you have tantalum and niobium with two different speciation. Then you can start by tantalum extraction before niobium extraction. For the tantalum extraction, You will use NIDT or you can use OctanTuber. These two solvents can be used to extract niobium and tantalum. Then you're going to extract tantalum first, and after the tantalum is going to go into the organic phase, then you have to strip to desextract the tantalum from the organic phase into the aqueous phase. Then you're going to use a stripping solution, and the tantalum is going into the stripping solution. And after that, you can perform tantalum precipitation with ammonia or KCl, because the solubility of tantalum is very low in this media. And after that, you have a tantalum precipitation, which can be calcined to form tantalum oxide or potassium tantalum oxide if you use KCl, potassium chloride. Then this is the reaction. You have the extraction of tantalum fluoride with NIBK to form these species. You can see that indeed you will have the co-extraction of proton with tantalum fluoride to form this species. After that, for the stripping, you have tantalum in the organic phase and you want to recover tantalum from the organic phase into the aqueous phase. For that, you're going to perform stripping by using water. It's very easy. Water is going to destroy the complex in the organic phase, and you will have MIBK, which is a ketone, and tantalum fluoride anion and acid. And after that, you can perform the precipitation by using, for instance, ammoniac or KCl to form these species, which have a very, very low solubility in aqueous media. For the, then here, you have extracted tantalum. Now you have in the flux of the aqueous phase, you have niobium. Then what you're going to do, you're going to acidify, because the extraction will be performed at another pH. Then you're going to add sulfuric acid, very high concentration of sulfuric acid. You can see that at the outstate, at the outlet of the acidification level stage, you have 9 molar of sulfuric acid. And after that, you can perform at this very high acidity, in high concentration of sulfuric acid, you can perform niobium extraction by using MIBK as well, or octanol. This is a reaction. What is the role of the acidification? By acidification, you can transform this anion by using HF and sulfuric acid into this species. And this species can be extracted by MIBK, while this species cannot be extracted. That's why in the previous stage, we were not able to extract with MIBK niobium, because niobium with this speciation cannot be extracted by MIBK. Then by adding sulfuric acid and HF, you're going to transform this species into this species, and this species can be extracted by MIBK by this reaction. And after, you just have to perform a stripping of niobium with water, like in the previous case. And you can precipitate with ammoniacal solution, and after that, calcine. Then you can see the process is not so easy, and it's very risky, very dangerous due to the presence of HF and the presence of MIBK. Then we had a project with the French society Eramet, within the framework of the Eramet-Mabumin project. In Gabon, there are deposits, pyroclore deposits containing uranium, rare earths, tantalum, niobium, but also iron, aluminium, and titanium. And then you can see that you have 1.2% of niobium, 300% of ppm of tantalum, 1.4% of rare earths, and 300 ppm of uranium. Of course, if you have rare earths, tantalum, niobium, and uranium, you have thorium as well. Then the goal of this project is to develop a sustainable hydrometallurgical process, which can be another option, an alternative for the recovery of niobium, tantalum, or on rare earth elements without using HF. That's why they want to, Eramet wanted to design a sustainable process for the recovery of these very valuable elements. How can we, first of all, what are the alternative media which can be used instead of HF? We can think about acidic media such as HCl, sulfuric acid, nitric acid. But niobium and tantalum exhibit very, very little solubility in these acids. We could think about the use of hydrogen peroxide or oxalic acid as complexing media. It's a solution, but oxalic acid is a little bit expensive. Or we can use basic media such as ammoniac, but niobium and tantalum exhibit very low solubility in ammoniac media. You have seen in the previous slide, we use ammoniac solution to precipitate niobium and tantalum. Then the other alternative is the use option is the use of alkaline media. Niobium and tantalum are soluble in this media, and alkaline media are not very expensive. Then in this project we focus on the use of alkaline media. You can see on this figure that when you what is the alkaline route? First of all, you have the mixture of the deposit, the ore containing niobium, tantalum, and you're going to add sodium hydroxide and potassium hydroxide at very high concentration in order to perform a caustic conversion.
When you say high,
it's 400 gram per liter.
How much?
400.
400 gram.
Yeah, it's not very high, but then you use. Sodium hydroxide in order to perform caustic conversion, and then here you're going to obtain a solid, and when you wash the solid you can put into solution niobium and tantalum. Then you will have niobium and tantalum in an alkaline solution by using this alkaline route. And you can see here the leaching efficiency during the water leaching stage as a function of the mass ratio of Ca2 to ore. You can see indeed that you will leach niobium, tantalum and titanium. You have a good selectivity for the leaching of niobium and tantalum against manganese, iron, aluminium and silicium. Of course, you extract titanium as well. Then it means that when you think about the purification, you think about the purification to extract selectively niobium and tantalum against titanium. Then, why do we have solubility of niobium and tantalum? We perform Raman spectroscopy, and you can see that here we have niobium oxide. This is the spectrum of niobium oxide. When we increase the pH of the solution, it means that we are more and more in alkaline media. You can see that you are going to transform niobium oxide into this species, and the solubility of this species, which is an oxonoliate, is very high. It's a species which is very soluble in water. Then finally, in water, what we have? In water, we have in solution this kind of species. We have polyoxonoliate and polyoxotantalate in solution. Then it means that the speciation of niobium and tantalum in alkaline media is this speciation, and we have to extract these species. Then we can perform that by solvent extraction of niobium from alkaline solution. It was investigated by Zhu and Tokuda in 2000. The solvent was aliquot 236. You remember, it was an anionic exchanger diluted in toluene for the study. Of course, in industry, we are not going to use toluene, we are going to use kerosene. But it was a scientific report in a paper. And the aqueous solution contained niobium. And in this paper, they suggested that the extraction occurs by using these three equilibria. And the same equilibria are expected for tantalum, as niobium and tantalum are very similar. Actually, the speciation of niobium in 2000 was not well known, and this equilibria are not good. The physical chemistry of extraction of niobium and tantalum is a little bit more tricky. If you report the variation of the distribution ratio as a function of the concentration of aliquot 2C6, the theory says you that you should have a linear relationship, and the slope of this curves must be equal to 7. Unfortunately, when we perform such an experiment, we see that the slope is not equal to 7, but the slope is between 1.6 and 2.3. That means that the extraction is more complicated than what we said here, if we consider what said Zhu and Tokeda, if we consider that this equation is responsible for the extraction. Then, why the slope is lower than 7? Perhaps there is co-extraction of alkaline ions with the oxopolynoviate. Perhaps we have a change in protonation degree of polynoviate during the extraction, or perhaps we have micellar extraction, because when you use aliquot 2C6, you can form micelles. If you perform sodium NMR of the organic phase, you can see here you have the sodium spectra of sodium chloride. This is a reference of the aqueous phase and the organic phase. And you can see that the spectrum of sodium NMR confirms that there is sodium co-extraction in organic phase. But the chemical shift is very similar as the chemical shift in aqueous phase or in the reference. This means that there is a co-extraction of sodium with niobium, but there is a small, very weak interaction between sodium and the hexaniobiate ions. If you have a look to the variation of the distribution ratio as a function of the ratio between cation and sodium, by using different kind of cations such as cesium, lithium or potassium, you can see that there is an influence of the presence of other cation in solution. If you use lithium, potassium or cesium, you will have different behavior. It means that the interaction between the alkali cation and hexaniobiate influence extraction. And we can say that more ion pairs are stable, more the extraction is difficult. And last but not least, if we have a look to the extraction efficiency as a function of the salt concentration, sodium carbonate or sodium sulfate, or sodium nitrate or sodium oxalate, you can see that you will have different behavior depending on the nature of the salt and the concentration of the salt. This means that beside the interaction between sodium and hexaniobiate, beside the interaction between alkali cation and hexaniobiate, you have a competition in the extraction of anion, which may occur. Last, if you have a look to the extraction efficiency as a function of the pH of the solution, you can see that you have a dependence of the extraction with the pH. If you have a look to this equation, you can see that if this equation was true, the pH should not change the extraction efficiency. The extraction efficiency should be independent, does not depend on the pH. But we observe that we have a dependence of the pH, of the extraction efficiency as a function of the pH. That means that the equation is not the good one. Then, niobium extraction is influenced by pH because polyoxoniobiate speciation depends on the pH. The extraction efficiency varies as a function of the protonation degree. It means that we have hydroxyl co-extraction, which increases when pH increases. Then, the hydroxyl competitive extraction decreases niobium extraction. Then, it means that the physical chemistry of niobium extraction, unlikely tantalum extraction, is really more tricky than what Zhu suggested in 2000. from the different experiments, we can see that actually we have this kind of equation which can explain the extraction of niobium, anton's iron, from alkaline solution. You have the influence of the cations, you have the influence of the proton, you have influence of the pH as well. And in particular, such a species is probably a mass cell. Then it means that supranuclear association of aliquot cannot be neglected to describe solvent extraction of niobium, and it can be assumed that extracted polyxenobiate is located inside the micelles, the micelle, this kind of micelles. Then you can see that it's not so easy, but it's very important to have an idea of the physicochemistry of extraction of niobium and tantalum, or more generally of metals, because if you have a good idea of what occurs in during the extraction, you can think about new extracting agent, you can model the process, and then you can have an idea of the optimized condition to perform the best separation of two metals like niobium and tantalum. But it's not so easy because sometimes the speciation is very complicated in the aquaspace, like in the case of niobium and tantalum, and you have supramolecular organization as well. Okay, then I don't know, it's time, I think so.
Yeah.